Hi! In this video, I'll show how magnetism can be used to change temperature and be very good at it. Like the electromagnet in an induction cooker, which makes a traditional cooker look archaic. But even a permanent magnet can be used to heat and cool through something called the magneto-caloric effect. It is very subtle and will not be easy to detect, but I have some strong magnets and will give it a try. Be careful when handling seriously strong magnets. Don't let the big magnets bite you. Boiling water is not friendly to humans. Don't touch it. And don't let gadolinium touch hot water either. In my previous video, I used the electromagnet in an induction cooker and was a little disappointed by the magnetic field strength from it. I would like to see how efficient this cheap induction cooker is compared to a cooker with a resistive heating element. The test is simple. Which one of them first brings 250 milliliters of water to a boil? The water is around 20 degrees Celsius from the start for both. Let the race begin. Seconds in and the induction cooker is already 10 degrees ahead. The resistive cooker first have to heat itself up, then heat the cookware, before the cookware can heat the water. The AC electromagnet in the induction cooker skips the first step. It heats the cookware right from the start by electrical resistance to induced eddy currents and magnetic hysteresis loss inside the cookware. 1 minute in and we are already seeing bubbles of water vapor on one of them, while the other, I swear, it is turned on. After 1.5 minutes, the induction cooker has a nice simmer going on. After 2 minutes, the induction has the water at a full rolling boil, while the other has reached fish tank temperature. It turns out that an AC magnetic field is very effective for heating magnetic things up, while a resistive heating plate on single phase 230 volts is rather rubbish. After 12 minutes, it still struggles to boil the water with no lid on the pot. Luckily, the stove in my kitchen is hooked up to 3-phase 400 volts. To be fair, the resistive cooker is only using 630 watts at 212 volts, while the induction cooker uses around 800 watts more at 202 volts. Still, the induction cooker used less total electricity. You may have noticed my wall power is at the low end in voltage. And voltage is important for a resistive cooker, which is basically just a simple resistor following Ohm's law. Looking at the formulas for dual heating, it is obvious that low voltage means less power for heating with a fixed resistance. If your house has a higher voltage supply, both of the cookers will be faster. Alright, let's switch from an AC electromagnet to a DC permanent magnet. This should be able to heat and cool some materials with a strong magneto-caloric effect. At room temperature, the element with the largest effect is gadolinium, a highly paramagnetic metal that turns ferromagnetic just below room temperature. You may have seen my tests in an earlier video. By a large magneto-caloric effect, I mean a tiny temperature change. It is not a strong effect, but I am hoping this thermometer can show it. Thanks to my awesome patrons for helping me out with this one and making this video possible. It uses a PT100 sensor, which is basically a platinum wire tuned to have a resistance of 100 ohms at 0 degrees Celsius. Platinum has a nice linear response between temperature and resistance. So the thermometer is simply measuring the resistance of the platinum inside the probe and translating it to temperature. At a high precision and high resolution of 0.01 degrees Celsius. Is that a centigrade? And more important, a magnetic field should have very little effect on the measurement. Yep, I see no major and persistent change near the magnet. My initial attempts with my largest magnet were promising, but too sloppy to be definitive. I believe I had two main issues. The magnetic field extends far for such a big magnet, so I never had the gadolinium out of the magnetic field for full effect. And the giant magnet worked as a giant heatsink when the gadolinium was touching it, countering the magneto-caloric effect. The effect should be a temperature rise in the gadolinium when it is in a strong magnetic field, and a temperature drop when it is removed again. After refining my test, I believe I caught the effect on camera with smaller, somewhat shielded but still very strong magnets. Here, the gadolinium is at a stable temperature. The magnets are not hotter, actually a little colder, so usually we would not expect the gadolinium to get warmer near the magnets. Where should the heat come from? But watch the effect as I move it into the magnetic field. The temperature of the gadolinium rises. A whopping 0.43 degrees Celsius out of nowhere. Okay, not much. But what happens when I remove it again? The temperature falls back. There is a small but clear and consistent temperature effect on the gadolinium from being in a magnetic field or not. The magneto-caloric effect. How does this work? It is a bit complicated. A thermodynamic effect on a molecular level. But here is how I understand it. We can simplify it by dividing the gadolinium into two subsystems with their own energy dispersal. The magnetic moments and the crystal lattice. Before being near a magnet, the magnetic moments are randomly fluctuating and not aligned like in a magnet. And the lattice vibrates in a manner linked to the temperature of the gadolinium. What I measure with the thermometer. When the gadolinium is put near a magnet, the magnetic moments are suddenly forced to align parallel to the magnetic field from the magnet. This effect is very strong in gadolinium, since it is the most paramagnetic element at room temperature. As the magnetic moments align, move, they transfer energy to the crystal lattice, making the lattice vibrate more. And this increased vibration, thermal kinetic energy, is an increase in the temperature of the gadolinium. Another way of looking at it is that the gadolinium loses some of its heat capacity by having the magnetic moment stuck in the aligned position, unable to fluctuate. With a sudden drop in heat capacity from being put near a magnet, the gadolinium gets hotter since it needs less energy to be at the same temperature than before. With no loss or gain in overall energy, it therefore gets hotter from the loss in heat capacity. When the gadolinium is removed from the magnetic field, it all reverses. The magnetic moments are no longer held in place by the magnets and can start fluctuating again by absorbing the vibrations in the lattice. With less vibration in the lattice, the gadolinium is colder. The gadolinium suddenly has regained its higher heat capacity and gets colder since it would need more energy to maintain its higher temperature. Now, this drop in temperature can be utilized for a refrigerator based on magnetism. The refrigeration cycle could go like this. Let a magneto-caloric material heat up in a magnetic field. Cool it down again using a heatsink while still in the magnetic field. Remove the heatsink and magnetic fields and the material now cools down to a lower temperature than before. Pass a refrigerant through the material and the refrigerant will be cooled down. Repeat the cycle. I will try this cycle by simply using the magnet itself as a heatsink. The gadolinium has stabilized at room temperature. For this experiment, I'll switch to Fahrenheit since it will make the changes more noticeable. After 5 slow cycles in 5 minutes, the gadolinium has dropped 1 degree Fahrenheit under the starting temperature. I would usually expect it to have warmed up using black epoxy-coated magnets under hot studio lights. So it looks like this refrigeration cycle does work, though 1 degree drop is not impressive. But by using better magneto-caloric materials and way higher cycle frequencies, researchers have made magnetic refrigerators. I hope they will be commercially available in a not too far future. I, for one, would love to have both a stove and a refrigerator based on magnetism in my kitchen. It could, maybe, make me spend more time out there practicing my gastronomic skills. Hope you enjoyed seeing how magnetism can affect temperature. I certainly had fun with the experiments. If you want to learn more about how to set up experiments and conduct them, then I have a great tip for you. Brilliant is a problem-solving website and app that teaches you how to think like a scientist with interactive courses and challenges. In the course, The Chemical Reaction, you'll learn the fundamentals of chemistry from the perspective of reactions. You'll work through puzzles and patterns to see how charge, energy, and probability combine to determine the basic behavior of molecules undergoing chemical reaction. By the end, you will be able to make predictions about simple chemical systems. I'm a fan of science and always like learning more about it. If you are like me, then I highly recommend you go to brilliant.org/brainiac75 and sign up for free. As a bonus, the first 200 people using the link will even get 20% off the annual premium subscription. Then you can do more crazy stuff without any safety warnings from me. Thanks to my awesome patrons for helping out with the platinum thermometer and several other measurement instruments for future videos, as I have shown in an unboxing video on patreon.com. If you have a dollar to spare too, to keep my channel going, there's a link in the description. Thank you very much. Bye for now.